let's move on to the next session. We have Professor Ashutosh Mahajan with us. He is a professor in operational research development at IIT Bombay. And he's going to tell us about the FOSI optimization toolbox. So welcome, Professor Mahajan. Also, this session will be conducted with Professor Mahajan along with Rupak. Rupak, you already know, is a project manager in FOSI. And he is a Scilab expert also. He's done his M.Tech in instrumentation and control system. So yeah, over to you, Professor Mahajan and Rupak. Thank you.
Professor Mahajan, are you there?
Yes, I'm very much here. Thank you, Rupak. Thank you everyone for joining in. My name is Ashutosh Mahajan. I hope you are able to hear me clearly. I am a faculty in Industrial Engineering and Operations Research Department at IIT Bombay for last 8 years or so. And I've been involved in the FOSI project for 6 or 7 years now. We have been doing several things along with Vanita and Rupak and many, many other people. It's a very exciting project, and we are quite enthusiastic about it. So without wasting too much time, may I request Rupak to start showing slides, please?
Yes, sir, I'll do that.
So that...
Yes, I will do it.
You know, it's easier for me.
Yes.
So today, in the next 90 minutes or so, we will try to understand what this toolbox is, this FOSI optimization toolbox that we have been developing for last several years. It is entirely open source and free software. The source code is available on Git. If you want to solve some optimization problems using some open source tools, this might be quite useful for you. We highly recommend this tool, and we'll be happy to assist you all of in using this tool even after this workshop. So if you face any optimization problem, or you want to tell students or your colleagues or your friends on how to solve optimization problems, and you try using this tool and you face any difficulties, please don't hesitate in contacting us. Okay, so you can easily look up my name on Google. My name is Ashutosh Mahajan again, and you should see my contact information online. Okay, so without further ado, let's start. Let's go to the first slide. So the main learning objectives for today's workshop is to just familiarize ourselves with optimization basics. Optimization is a very nice subject, both theoretically and practically. Technically or theoretically, it is somewhat mathematical, somewhat oriented towards computer programming, oriented towards heuristics and exact methods. So it's very interesting, at least for me, and I love teaching optimization, and I've been doing it fortunately for last 8 years at IIT Bombay. We will look at a few types of optimization problems. So some optimization problems can be very difficult to solve. They are like hard puzzles that you might see in games you play, or in riddles that you solve. Some problems are fairly easy. Some problems are fairly hard. Okay, so we will talk a little bit about what are the different types of optimization problems, because different types of optimization problems need different types of solvers and solution approaches. So, for example, a linear programming problem can easily be solved using a simplex method or an interior point method, but the same method will not work for nonlinear programming. Okay, you need a different type of algorithm for nonlinear optimization. So in the area of optimization, many times we use the word programming instead of optimization, because optimization as a subject started little before computers were invented. And at that time, in 1930s, 1940s, people didn't use the word programming for computer programming. In 1930s and 1940s, programming or programs meant planning. Okay, and this optimization is very useful tool when you want to make a plan. Either you want to plan your budget or your finances, or you want to plan your production for the next 1 year. Or you want to plan your holidays, or you want to plan a party, anything that you do in real life, you have to take some decisions, and some decisions are better than other decisions. And mathematical optimization is one way to find, you know, what are these good decisions. So one can say linear optimization or one can say linear programming. They are exactly the same. So we have developed this toolbox. It's called the FOSSI optimization toolbox, because you know it's a part of our FOSSI project, and we have tried to make the toolbox as usable as possible for everybody. So it depends. The latest version of the toolbox that we have is version 0.4. It is not entirely stable in the sense that occasionally you might see some bugs here or there, but some parts like linear optimization and unconstrained optimization and bounded programming and constrained programming, they are quite stable, and you should be able to solve those problems without any problems. Okay, we have routines in the toolbox for many, many types of optimization problems. The basic ones are the linear optimization and general nonlinear optimization. Nonlinear optimization is a very, very big, vast topic in itself. Nonlinear means anything which is not linear. That means 99% of the world would be not linear. So within nonlinear optimization, you can have quadratic programming, you can have unconstrained programming or multi-objective goal programming, and so on and so forth. Okay, integer programming is a different beast. In integer optimization, you want some variables to only take integer values. So for example, if you are making a plan for the Indian Navy, and you want to say how many warships should be allocated to which side of the country, you can't run an optimization model and say that 1.5 ships should be on the west coast and half a ship should be on the east coast, right? You need discrete values of your integers. So either you can have one ship or two ships or three ships. You can't have something fractional. So those problems are called integer programming, and it may sound strange, but integer programming problems tend to be much more difficult than linear programming or nonlinear programming problems. Okay, and also integer programming problems tend to have many, many applications. For example, finding shortest paths in your map. Or if you are planning a road trip, then finding the smallest tour, like the traveling salesman person problem. Or, you know, things like problems which Amazon solves every day. For example, the delivery person from Amazon, he has to deliver packets to 20 different people on the same day. So in what sequence he should deliver those packets? Okay. So those are combinatorial problems and can be solved using integer programming. Well, our toolbox is entirely open source in the sense that whatever code we have written is fully open source. Also, our code depends on many other solvers. So what we have done is we have not really developed any new solvers. We take the best of the best open source optimization solvers which are currently available, and we take the libraries and we write methods so that these libraries can be called from Scilab. Okay, so we are not doing the real hard work and very technology sensitive part where you have to develop new solvers. That is a problem which many other people have been solving and successfully doing it for last several years. What we are doing is just having wrappers around them and being able to call them from Scilab. And that is the beauty of open source. Some people develop one part of the code, other people who are totally not related to those people or are not working in the same company, they borrow their code and develop something on top of that. And that's how open source ecosystem survives and thrives and grows. So for example, our toolbox depends on CLP, which is a linear programming solver available from CoinOR. And CLP was developed as an open source solver by some very smart people from IBM. It's a C library, C++ library, and you can go online and download it. But it is not very useful in itself because if you want to solve any problem, then you have to first write a C++ program and then include CLP solver calls as a library call and then solve it. It's very, very cumbersome. On the other hand, if you download our toolbox in Scilab, you can do the same thing in about half an hour, things that might take about one day to write. Okay, so the advantage of using Scilab is that it is very user friendly. It is slightly slow when solving things because you have to first translate everything from Scilab to the language that CLP understands. Okay, so there is a little bit of performance issue if you are solving extremely big problems, but for most problems Scilab is very advantageous. Because the human time in writing code and solving reduces a lot. Okay? Your CPU might run for 10 minutes extra, but your human time in coding and calling a program will be reduced drastically by a few hours. So that is the big advantage of a tool like Scilab. Okay? So other solvers that we use are CLP, IPOP, CBC, Bonvin Symphony. They are all open source. They are all available on GitHub. You can search for coinor.org, coin, C-O-I-N, OR as in operations research. It's a big effort by professors from leading universities of the world and corporations like IBM and many others, where people get together and develop nice algorithms and software for optimization. And we are extending that those libraries so that they can be used within Scilab using our toolbox. What we have also tried is that people who are familiar with the optimization toolbox of MATLAB have very less difficulty in migrating to Scilab. So we have tried to keep function names and arguments similar to those available in the MATLAB optimization toolbox. Our toolbox is available for all platforms, Windows, Mac, Linux. Mac is somewhat less tested because we don't find Mac easily with our staff and users. For example, I don't have my Mac myself, so it's difficult to test it. Okay, but if you are using Mac, please do inform us and let us know if there are any issues that you see. These are some links you can see on your screen for where Scilab optimization toolbox, FOSI optimization toolbox is available. Atoms is a website of Scilab, atoms.scilab, where a lot of toolboxes are available for Scilab. Ours is also available. You can install FOT either directly through Scilab without going to the scilab.org website, or you can go to Atoms, the above website, and download this thing and then run it on your computer. Okay, so either way is fine. Source code is available on GitHub. You can fork it just now if you want, or do it later and start contributing immediately. All right. So let's come quickly to optimization. So very simply put, suppose you have 10 choices and you want to pick the best choice. How will you do it? Okay, so one option is to evaluate all the 10 choices and then pick the best. Okay, in many practical applications, the number of choices is extremely, extremely large. It might be 10 billion or you know, 20 million or some. And there is no way you can evaluate each and every option available and then pick the best. So mathematically, what you would like to do is develop some smart algorithm so that you can find the maximum or minimum or the best fit without trying all possible options. Okay, so that is called mathematical optimization, and for that you know, there are all these various solvers available. So these are some terms that you might see on your screen, which come when you start doing mathematical optimization, and you know, this is the jargon of optimization, you know, if you want to write a model, if you want to ask a computer to solve an optimization problem, some of these are really important. Okay, so objective function is the function that you would like to minimize or maximize. So suppose you want to minimize the cost, so then you have to write a mathematical function for what is the cost, and that is your objective function. Okay. So constraints are things where you want your variables to be restricted. Okay, so you want to tell the computer that a certain variable x1 should not be more than 10, and it should not be less than, say, 0. Okay, so those are constraints. Okay. Constraints can also be complicated. So for example, you might say that sum of three variables, x1 plus x2 plus x3 should be less than equal to some number, say 10, okay, and so on and so forth. So depending on your practical application, you might have many, many constraints. Okay. So bounds are the special types of constraints where you only have one variable. So for example, if you say that my variable x1 is between 0 and 1, that is a bound constraint. Okay, so you are saying that put a bound on x1. Okay. Gradients, I think you all might be familiar. Gradients are derivatives in higher dimensions. Okay, so your first derivative of a multivariate function is actually a vector, and it is called a gradient. Okay, so it's a vector of partial derivatives. So if you have a function f, then del f by del x1, del f by del x2, del f by del x3, so on and so forth. If you look at these n terms, that gives you the gradient. Okay. Hessian is similarly the second derivative of a multivariate function. Feasibility means, you know, we say that a point is feasible if it satisfies all constraints. Okay. So optimization is trying to figure out what are all the possible feasible solutions, and then which amongst those is the best. So that is what we are trying to find. All right. And hopefully through examples, which Rupak is going to explain later on in this workshop, you will get some idea of, you know, what is feasible and what is a constraint and what are bounds if these things are new to you. All right. A general linear programming is, as the name suggests, you know, it's an optimization problem where all the functions of variables are linear. Okay, so my objective function is C transpose X, which is a linear function in X. Okay, so in these problems, A, B, C, L, B, U, B, these are given, and the only unknown is X. And you would notice that you know, everywhere X appears, it appears in a linear function. There are no terms like x square or x cube or sine of x or x1 upon x2 and so on and so forth. Okay, so these problems are called linear programming problems. Okay, so similarly, there are other types of problems also. So when you want to call our toolbox, or as a matter of fact, any solver that you would like to call to solve a linear programming problem, then you have to specify some inputs. So what would be the inputs for this problem? The inputs are the things which are already given and already known. So those are C, A, B, A, E, Q, B, E, Q, L, B, and U, B. Okay. So A, you know, the capital A and capital A, E, Q, these are matrices. Okay, these are big matrices. B and C are vectors, and LB and UB are also vectors. And Rupak will be able to explain these things more in his part shortly, right? So so maybe you know it's time for Rupak to now take over, because he will go into the details of you know how the toolbox can be called. And you know how a solution from a toolbox looks like, and other you know fine details, and Rupak is quite an expert in this, and he has contributed a lot. So feel free to ask him any questions. I will be around for a few more minutes, but you know I may have to leave. But if there are some questions, I'll be happy to answer them over email also. Rupak would be there anyway. And towards the end, you know, I might be able to just join back and see if there are you know more questions for me. Okay, so with that, I will stop and hand over the proceedings to Rupak.
Thank you, sir. So first of all, I would like to mention that this FOSI optimization toolbox that we're able to conduct a workshop on is essentially possible due to the serious efforts by Professor Ashutosh Mahajan. And with his guidance and his direction, we could build such a tool. And we are really grateful towards him to help us in doing this. And I would request sir to join back after my demo is over, so that if people are having any you know, specific optimization queries, they could get an answer from you. As sir said, I'm an expert, but actually I'm not. I'm just a beginner in the optimization theory. My role essentially was more like a programmer. But yeah, as I work, I do understand now a few things about it. So thank you very much, sir, for the introduction. I would now start with the demonstration of this toolbox. So as sir said, this is a general form of linear programming, and here is the objective function. Now in this case we are trying to minimize
sorry to interrupt, Rupak. Yeah. Before you go ahead, just want to make a small announcement. We have posted the attendance on the chat. Please mark your attendance before 1. Thank you. Sorry, Rupak, continue.
Okay, so here is the objective function, and we are trying to minimize this objective function, and we represent it as C transpose X. Then we have some constraints over here. So these constraints are you know as shown. One of the constraint is that something has to be you know less than or equal to something. Then something has to be equal to something, and then something can only fall in some bounds, like lower bound and upper bound. Okay. So as sir said, these all become the inputs to our function. And ideally, all of these parameters must be given. Okay, these are all given things. And as far as FOT is concerned, we have made available a function called as linprop. So in the recent versions of FOT, that is 0.4, we have renamed this function to FOT_linprop. Okay. But I'll refer it to as linproc. I don't want to call FOT underscore every time. I'll just say linproc. I'll just call out the function name, which has to be understood as FOT underscore the function name. So as you can see, all these parameters, the objective functions, the C, A, B, A, Q, B, Q, L, B, U, B, these are all the input parameters to the linproc function. Similarly, we also have output functions, the optimal value, the optimal value of the x, the optimal value of the objective function evaluated at x, exit flag, output lambda. So all of these are the output parameters that could be of interest to you. In most cases, these two are ideally enough for you to understand what happened to the could the problem be solved by FOPT. So by looking at XOPT and FOPT, you should be able to figure out whether the optimal solution has been found or not. So now let us jump to an example to do linear programming. Now here, in this case, we start with minimizing an objective function, which is given by minus x1 minus 3x2. Okay? And the constraints are given here. What do you see as the constraints? X1 plus x2 should be less than or equal to 2. Then minus 0.25 x1 minus x2 should be less than or equal to 1. Minus x1 minus x2 less than or equal to minus 1. Minus x1 plus x2 less than or equal to minus 2. And then there are some equality. There is an equality constraint, which is x1 plus 0.25 x2 is equal to 0.5. Now we also mentioned bounds, right? So there are some bounds that have to be applied on x1 and x2. This problem demands that x1 cannot fall beyond minus 1.5, and x2 cannot fall beyond below and above minus 0.5 and infinity. Okay, so these are all defined. Whoever designs the objective, the optimization problem will define all of this. This is basically, you know, what you want the solver to follow while finding a solution. Now, as you can see, this is all written in mathematics and you can easily write this in paper. But now how do you convey this to Scilab and essentially FOPT? That process is called as formulation. Formulation into Scilab understandable language. So what does Scilab understand? Scilab understands only matrices. So you have to first convert all of these into matrices. So C, as the objective function is C. So you basically write the coefficients of x1 and x2 as a, here it is represented as a column vector. Then all the constraints, the inequality constraints, they are all represented as A. You can see I'm basically just putting the numbers here and pasting the coefficients here, but I'm also retaining the signs. Okay. I'm not ignoring the signs. If there is a negative sign, I'll retain it. Okay. Then there is an equality constraint. And I represent it as like this. Coefficient of x1 is 1 and x2 is 0.25. The lower bound is given like this. Now we all saw the left hand side of the equations. Similarly, we also have to represent the right hand side, and you call each of them, you know, accordingly. For example, for the inequality constraints, for the RHS, you say B. So B is another column vector. You see, I am replicated this RHS, 2, 1, minus 1, 2, 2, 1, minus 1. Similarly, for the B equivalent, B equality is 0.5, and the upper bounds are here, which is 1.5 and percent infinity. So now, once we do this, now we can easily, you know how to define a matrix in Scilab, right? So all you have to do is simply make these definitions in Scilab. Write these definitions, declare C, declare A, EQ, LB, B, BQ, and U. And then with all this data ready, you call the linproc function. So now I'll do that in Scilab. I have Scilab running with me. And I have also loaded FOSSI optimization toolbox already in my Scilab. And now I have coded these functions already in Scilab. I have already coded these functions in Scilab, and I'll simply open the corresponding files and run the code. Okay. So first is the linear programming problem, which I have written it inside the linproc. By the way, these files that you see, circular tank, linproc, nonlinear toy, these all problems are essentially code files, and they have been given to you, you know, as a part of the additional learning material. You could see it as an FOT zip file, FOT files. So there you will find these examples. If you want in this live session, if you want, you can run the code in parallel to me. But in order to be stick to the time schedule. I will not essentially wait for you to finish executing the code. I'll go as slow as possible so that you can follow me, but it is not necessary for you to line by line follow my commands. You can do it in parallel or you can do it later. I will actually suggest you to just observe what I'm doing right now so that you understand it properly. These files are anyways available. You can always run them anytime you want. But what is important is that what does the file represent and how do you go about coding such examples so that you can write your own examples in the future, right? So let us open this linprog file. I have opened this linprog file here. You can see it. Make it a little more bigger. Yeah. So as you can see, I have declared C, A, B, A, Q, B, Q, L, B, and U, B.
Excuse me?
Yes.
We can see only the PDF.
You can see only the PDF? I'm sorry, I should have shared my entire desktop. Give me a minute. Thank you for pointing that out. Can someone confirm if you can see my screen now, both the PDF and the Scilab?
Yes, they are visible.
Okay, thank you very much. So you see, I have defined these variables, which I have shown on the slides. And now these are now available for me to call the linprog function. As I said, it is called as FOT_linprog. And I am expecting only the XOPT and FOPT output. Now the sequencing in which you expect the outputs is actually important. You can't expect the FOPT output to appear first and XOPT to appear second. No. It will appear in an order and you have to interpret it accordingly. You have to be careful when you do that. So let us execute this. I'll click on execute and I'll click on file with echo. So you see, it didn't take much time for Scilab to run this example. It was relatively simpler. And you can also see that there is a message, it says optimal solution. And it is giving me the optimal solution. Okay. So what I did right now, I have explained it in this slide, what code to execute along with the file name and along with the instructions to install and load the toolbox. Okay. So the solution to the example is here. The optimal value is 0 and 2. X1 is 0 and X2 is 2. And the objective functions, when you evaluate it at this point, X1 and X2, you will get -6. You can substitute it in second for yourself. That is how simple it is to solve a linear programming problem. Okay. Now let us go ahead and move to the next problem. So last problem was minimization problem. This problem is a maximization problem. So in the maximization problem, what we do is we change the signs. Okay. And we are going to use the same linprog function, but with the flipped signs. Why? Because we are trying to do the maximization problem. Linprog by default will assume that you want to minimize the objective function. Okay, so if you want to maximize the objective function, you adjust the signs accordingly. So we will do the maximization problem with an example, with an intuitive example rather. And this is what you see on my screen is essentially a word problem. And this word problem, I'll just read out the word problem. So what it says is that there is an Alftype toy assembly. So there is a company called as Alftype assembly. And it basically assembles toys. Now, what kind of toys? Trains, trucks, and cars. Okay. It assembles trains, trucks, and cars. Now, there is a daily limit. Now I'll start talking about what is expected, what it can do, what it cannot do, what are the constraints and all. So you will come to know that the English language is getting converted or translated rather into an optimization problem. And you will yourself identify the variables as I read out the problem, right? So the Alftype company assembles three toys, trains, trucks, and cars. Okay, but there is a daily limit on how much time these three operations can be done. So it assembles trains, trucks, and cars using three operations. Now, when I say three operations, it could be anything. It could be just, you know, three machines, you know, operating or the process of assembling these toys. And there's a daily limit to how much time for how long these three operations can be executed in a day. Okay. So 4:30 minutes, the first operation will run. 4:60 minutes, the second operation will run. And 4:20 minutes, the third operation will run. Okay. Now, each of these toys, for example, train, if you want to assemble a train, you will need all these three operations. Okay. If you want to assemble a truck, you will need all these operations. If you want to assemble a car, you will need all these operations. Okay. So essentially, one machine is getting shared between three products, right? And each of this iteration is going to take some time. Okay. So what this line is saying that collectively, when you operate this system, you can only run it for a given number of minutes. That is what the second line is. The third line says, now you're talking about the revenue. Now, when you manufacture or rather assemble these trains and trucks and cars, you get a revenue of 30 rupees, 20 rupees, and 50 rupees respectively. Okay, this is the cost. You know, you can call it as a profit or revenue, right? Then the third next piece of information is that, like I said, each machine is going to be shared by these three products, and these are given, you know, here. So the corresponding times on each machine per train, per truck, and per car are 131, 204, and 120. Okay, so you understood this, right? And wherever you see a zero, it means that that operation is not used. Okay, just give me a second. So the first operation is taking 131 minutes to assemble trains, trucks, and cars. Similarly, the remaining, 204, 120. Now, what is it that you want to do with this problem? You want to determine the optimum production rate to maximize the profit. Now, any company is going to only be interested, mostly be interested in, you know, the profit, right? So that is the optimization problem here. But here we are trying to maximize the objective function, which is profit, right? And determine what is the optimal production rate so that the profit is maximized. You understand? Now, translating such a word problem into an optimization theory language is known as formulation. Okay, so you should know how to formulate this problem onto paper first, you know, in equations x1, x2, in variable terms. Then you have to identify the relevant matrices, like we saw in the earlier slide, A, B, U, B, L, B, all these things. And then once you have matrices defined, Scilab can be easily used, right? Once you have things defined as matrices, you can easily call any functions in Scilab, any function in Scilab, and do the calculation. Okay. So let us formulate it. So now I will now try to do the first step here, develop a LP formulation on paper for this problem. So notice that I'm saying max of x, right? So I'm trying to maximize this objective function. What is this objective function? 30x1 plus 20x2 plus 50x3. Where this came from?
Profit.
Yeah. We can say, why did I choose this? Because that was my objective, right? Maximizing the profit. So I chose that revenue line, the sentence, and I translated it to my objective function, right? 30x1, 20x2 plus 50x3. And what are the constraints? Now, these constraints you can see here, x1 plus 2x2 plus x3 less than or equal to 430. What is this? Now, these constraints are here. These constraints are over the operations, the times, the minutes that, you know, x1, x2, x3 spends, right? Now, x1, x2, x3 are essentially the products, right? X1 stands for trains, x2 stands for trucks, and x3 stands for cars, okay? And you understand, right? So each operation is going to, you know, apply some constraint on time. And these are the three constraints because we have three operations. So I now converted it to related matrices, right? So it is easy. Now notice that I told you that linprog will by default do minimization. So if you want to do maximization, you have to flip the signs. So 30x1, 30, 20, 50 becomes minus 30, minus 20, minus 50. And the x1, x2, x3, x1, x3, all this constraint, A matrices can be translated as it is using the coefficients. And wherever you see something absent, you write zero. Okay. Then equality constraints, there is nothing, you don't read out anything in the problem that something has to be equal to something, right? So equality is null. Lower bound 0, 0, 0. You don't have any lower bounds here. Next, let us translate the right hand side of the equation, which is 430, 460, 420. Again, the equality of the RHS doesn't exist for this problem, so it is null again. Again, the upper bound can be anything, so I'm writing infinity. Okay, now that's it. So now what is left is you go ahead and execute this example. So I'll just do that in silence. So I have this file called as toy.sc. I'm mentioning that file name here, toy.sc. So I'll open that file. Hopefully I did not make a mistake. So I'll switch to the, So C, A, B, I have defined. Okay, other things, you can directly write, you can also directly write the values here while you call the function. You need not declare them as I did earlier, but it is, it looks elegant and it is readable. So you declare it and then simply put the variable names. But you can always define the A matrix here itself, like I've done for the upper bound and lower bound. So that's it. And again, I'm expecting only X OPT and F OPT. So I will execute this file with echo. Here it is. You see the following values, right, for XOPT and FOPT. So X1, X2, X3 is coming out to be optimal value of X1 is 0, X2 is 100, and X3 is 230. Now, how do you interpret this? What it is trying to say is that given that the revenue that you will earn in each of these products, and given that there are some time constraints on each of the operations, if you manufacture 0 trains, 100 trucks, and 230 cars, you will get the maximum profit. That is what the problem is trying to tell. The solution is trying to tell, rather. Right? And FOPT is negative. Why negative? Minus 13,500. So minus 13,500 is essentially, so I told you that LeanProg is going to do only minimization. So in other words, you can read minus 1350 as negative loss, minimization of loss, essentially, right? So the loss is minimized. In other words, the profit is maximized. So you will earn 13,500 INR profit if you do this. Understood? I hope that problem was clear to everybody. Moving on, next we will see a nonlinear programming problem. And this is the general form of the nonlinear programming problem. Here again, we are starting with minimization of the objective function. And when I say nonlinear, it means that there could be nonlinearity at two places or both places. One is the nonlinearity could be present inside the objective function itself. So for example, this you see, there is no square term here, right? There is no nonlinearity here. Even here also, there is no nonlinearity. It's straightforward, linear. Whereas in case of nonlinear, there could be some square terms, cube terms appearing in the objective function. They could also appear in the constraints, or both, at both places. Okay, we'll see such cases now. And in order to solve nonlinear optimization problems of nonlinear nature in FOT, you have to use fmincon function. Fmincon. This is what the FOT toolbox offers if you want to solve a nonlinear optimization problem. Okay, you cannot use LeanProg; it will not do it for you. So I don't want to repeat all of this. Again, there are some inputs to the function. There are some outputs. Now here are some new inputs here. For example, NLC. NLC, you see it later. But essentially, the objective function now is no longer a matrix, right? You don't see C over here. There is no C. Okay, there is an F, right? So I'll show you in the next slide. Okay, the next slide is about output. Again, the same thing. I don't want to repeat this. So, so let us start with an example for nonlinear optimization. And to be, you know, as simple as possible, I'm choosing the nonlinearity to be present only in the objective function. Okay, you can see that the constraints are all linear. I don't have any square terms here. I have square terms only inside the objective function. And again, I'm representing it in terms of x1 and x2. Okay, now formulation. Now this problem could come from some other word problem. Okay, but I'm using this as the starting point. Okay, just like the elf toy problem. No? It started from a word problem, then we translated to this form, and then we translated to matrix form. Okay, but now I'm for this case I'm doing it from the equation form. Now the good thing to notice here is that the objective function is no longer a matrix or a vector. It is rather a Scilab function. I hope that all of you have watched the scripts and functions spoken tutorials, right? So I'm assuming that all of you are familiar in, you know, writing a Scilab function. Excuse me if there is a disturbance from my side. It is really unavoidable, quite unfortunate also. So sorry for that. So moving on. The objective function becomes a Scilab function. And so what I've done is I've simply translated, you know, this x1 square minus x1 x2 upon 3 plus x2 square into a Scilab function. It is the same thing. Okay, simply a function. That's it. And then the A matrix, you know how what is A and what is B, right? The left hand side of x of this constraints becomes the A, the right hand side becomes the B. And because this is a non-linear problem, we have to assume the initial value to be 0, 0. I'm assuming actually. We have to assume some initial value. So that is 0, 0 in this case. And how do you call? What is the calling sequence? You simply call FOT, FMINCON and pass all of these. Okay. Again, this slide talks about what code to run and what are the things that you should be ready with. So I'll switch to Scilab and I will run the nonlinear 1.sce file. So you see the objective function here. I have defined a function, Scilab function, which represents the objective function. Okay. Then x0 is there, a is there, b is there. Simple as that. I'll execute this code. And I find some optimal solution. Okay. Is it in agreement to what I have here? Okay, it is in agreement to what I have here. So now because this problem was not really realistic enough, so don't try to make sense out of why XOPT is like this and why FOPT is like this. But it is not a realistic problem. We are choosing some numbers and we are trying to optimize it. It is just an example. Okay, but what it is trying to say is x1 the optimal value of x1 is 0.00001 and similarly x2. And when you evaluate the objective function at x1 and x2, you will get this. Moving on. So the next case is that what if there is a non-linearity, you know, in objective function as well as in the constraints, right? So let us see what to do. So you would have guessed it now. Just like we, you know, wrote a function, a Scilab function for objective function, we have to write a function for the non-linear constraints. How do we do that? Here it is. This is the function definition for the objective function. Again, not everything is non-linear. There are some linear terms also. A is linear, B is linear. X0 is again 0, 0. And the non-linear constraints are represented like this. Again, I'm just writing. I'm simply translating it from the problem. If you look closely. By the way, if you look up here, so these are not equality constraints. These are less than equal to type of constraints. So that is the reason why the CEQ is null. I'm defining CEQ to be null. And C to be defined as per the constraint here. X1 square minus 1, that is the first term. And x1 square minus x2 square minus 1, second term. Okay. That's it. Now you call the FOT FMINCON function with all of these definitions. You have defined F, F is your objective function and calling it as F. F is a very bad name, but it makes the calling sequence a little simpler. Then X naught is initial value A, B, A, Q, B, Q, L, B, U, B, and S. All of these input definitions, and you generate the output. Again, I will switch to my Scilab and I will execute this nonlinear two file. Objective function is here. All the values are here. A, Q, B, Q, L, B, U, B. And also the NLC function, the non-linear constraints. NLC stands for non-linear constraints. This is just a nomenclature, just a tag name that we follow. Again, I will execute this code. If you can execute, if you can find the code, and I will get some solution. What does it say? So remember, you have to see this message also. Sometimes there are some problems, you know, which will go undefined. The solver is not able to solve it. So it will say optimal solution not found. Okay, but in this case, we have found the optimal solution. And the solution is given. I hope things are clear until this point. Okay. Let's move on to the next slide.
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes.
When you are there were two inequalities in C. So you are representing it with the bracket, like means one and then comma and the other one.
Yes, yes.
So if there are three, so that means in the same square bracket we can put it.
Yes, yes. Extend and the it same will,
yeah. Okay, and but it will be represented by C only, one C means variable is that name is only one.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, thank you.
So that was the solution for the previous problem. Now I think this is the last problem that I will choose to explain. Again, this I am choosing it to be a word problem because it makes more sense. You know, when you try to relate something to the real world. So what does this problem say? We are trying to design something. What we are trying to design? We are trying to design a circular tank. Now the name is maybe not a very good name, but what is it trying to say is we are trying to construct a cylinder. Okay, I'm calling it as a circular tank. The cylinder, and that cylinder is closed at both ends. Okay, so now you see how the constraints and all the parameters come up as I read the constraint. The volume of the cylinder has to be 200 meter cube. Okay, first constraint. As soon as I read this, you understand that, okay, this is a constraint. I cannot design a cylinder lesser than 200 meter cube volume. Right? I need 200 meter cube. The cost, now next problem, next statement says, is what says it? What does it say is that the cost of manufacturing such a tank is proportional to the surface area, right? Because the amount of material that will be required to build such a tank, you know, it depends on the how much is the raw material cost, right? So I'm trying to say is that the cost is proportional to the surface area of the material, which is priced at, you know, for 400 rupees per meter cube. So whatever material that you use to build a tank is costing you 400 per meter cube. Okay, that is the cost constraint. Okay, now next, what does it say? When you make this tank, you are going to put it somewhere, right? And you're going to put it inside a shed. Now this shed has a sloping roof, which means that there is a limit to how tall you can, you know, make this tank. So there is a limit to the height of the tank, right? And the problem is trying to represent this height in this equation. What does it say? Height can be less than or equal to 12 minus d by 2. Now what is d? D is, you would have guessed, d is the diameter of the tank. Okay, this is the constraint over the height of the tank. Now what do you have to do? Formulate the minimum cost problem and solve the design problem. So which means that we have to find out how much it is going to cost us to build such a cylinder or a tank, I would say. Now the same step you have to follow. Develop a problem formulation first of all on the paper. You have to first should be able to translate it into equations first. That is the first step. Second, you translate those equations into matrices. Once you have the matrices, you can easily use SAL. And again, this is a nonlinear programming problem. So I am using fmin term. Okay. So as I said, let us now start formulating it. The objective function given here, you know, what is it? Let us go back to this slide. Yeah. So the objective is here to minimize the cost rate, to find out the cost rate, the optimal cost. And somehow it is dependent on the area of the cylinder, right? So that becomes my objective function, right? So area of a cylinder is given by 2 pi RH plus 2 pi R square. And I'm trying to include the cost also here. So 400 times something. Why? Because the rate of the material is, you know, is priced at that rate, 400 per meter cube. So that becomes my objective function. So now you see R plus H less than equal to 12. Where is this coming from? From here. Okay, I'm just simply, I'm writing D as twice of R. And then I shuffle the terms and I get this. R plus H is less than 12. What is the next constraint? The volume, right? We have a constraint over the volume. You cannot have any less or more volume. You want this volume, 200 meter. Okay. So essentially, it is actually an equality constraint, right? You don't want anything more, you don't want anything less. You want 200. So what does it say? 200 minus pi r square h. Pi r square h is the volume of the cylinder. Is equal to zero. Okay. Now there is another constraint which the problem doesn't say, but it is very obvious, is that the radius of the tank cannot get negative, right? You cannot have a negative radius. And you also cannot have a negative height, right? You are building up, not down. So, with that constraint becomes R and H cannot be less than or equal to zero. Okay, you cannot have even have a zero radius, right? So moving on. So now we have defined all of this, right? So now we'll go ahead and write the equivalent SILAB code. This is the objective function tank problem. X takes the variable X, and X1 is, I'm defining it as a radius, and X2 as the height. So what are we trying to optimize here? This one, 400 2 pi RH plus 2 pi RH square. Here it is. Okay. Then initial values of X and linear constants are defined as A, B, X0, lower bound. Okay. This is as per what you see here. Then nonlinear constraints was on this, right? On the volume of the cylinder. So I wrote a NLC function in which I defined what is X1 and X2. And C becomes null. CAQ becomes this. So you notice that in the earlier problem, C was defined and CAQ was null. But here the CAQ is defined and C is null. Okay, you have to be careful about this also. So once you have this, you know, it's basically a code representation in my slide, SILAB code representation. So now once you are done this, you are okay. You're ready to go. This is the calling sequence, calling of fmincon, tank problem. Tank problem is basically the objective function's name. Okay. So I'll switch to SILAB. Circular tank is the file name. I have written it here. Okay, I've written it here. Circular tank.sc. And so all the definitions are given here. I'll click on execute, I'll click on file with it. So optimal solution is found. So we were operating on X1 and X2. And what was X1 and X2? What was X1 and X2? X1 was radius and X2 was height. Okay, because radius and height is all that you need to design a cylinder, right? And this is the optimal solution. So what does it say? Oh, I did not, did I execute? Yeah, I executed it. So you see the problem solution is as shown in the slide, it matches, right? Yeah. So what does it say? The radius has to be of this height, of this measurement, this unit. The height has to be this 6.33 meters. And when you make such a tank, it is going to cost you 75,000 rupees, approximately 75,720. This is what the solver gives me, right? So that is how, this is how you can use, this is only a, you know, scratching the surface situation. FOT can do much, much more than what I showed, but I don't want to complicate things and, you know, due to time constraints and, you know, other things. there's a limit to how much we can show. And because most people could be new to optimization, it is rather simpler to understand also, and to me to convey also. Okay, so I think, yeah. So with that, I am done with the presentation. Now, you know, in this slide, what I'm trying to say is that we have coded many examples in Scilab optimization, this FOSI optimization toolbox, and these are all available on our website. So you go to scilab.in, FOSI Scilab toolbox, and there you will see these examples. In fact, the circular time problem that you saw just now is also available there. Okay, I have explained the same problem. I thought it was worth explaining because it had it was capturing most things that a beginner would want to know. Okay, so I think Vinita, I'm done. Professor Mahajan is still there. I'm not sure if Professor Mahajan.
So any questions?
Yeah, if you have simpler questions, you can ask me. If you have much complicated questions, I would request you to please write it in the chat. Professor Mahajan will answer.
Yes, excuse me, sir. Sir, like in MATLAB, we got help for like, see, if it is fmincon like we are using here. Now, about the arguments you have explained, which arguments, what does that mean? But like if I am using any other function maybe, or I wanted to know what does that each argument mean. Means it, do we have that help kind of feature for
yes, in yes. this? So I'll so show how you. To, yeah, yeah. yeah, I'll show you. So you can see my Scilab software,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
Here, if you type help, first of all, it will open the general Scilab help. Okay. But on the left-hand side, if you scroll down, you will see the toolbox, FOSI optimization toolbox.
Yeah.
If you click on it, it will give you all the help, all you know, topics, okay. various functions. So for example, fmincon, if I click.
So it will give. So it will tell me about all the parameters.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. So if you have any questions, please put them on the chat, and we'll be happy to answer you. After the workshop also, if you have any questions, you can write to us. Professor Mahajan has told you can write to him also. Or, you know, if you have a general query, you can write to contact@scilab.in. And we'll be happy to answer you. So with this, I will conclude my talk.
Yeah, any questions, so Rupak? No questions, I guess. So Rupak, I think we didn't give them much time to do the previous practice problem. So let them solve the practice problem until 1. And then at 1, we can break for lunch.
There was one query, Vinita ma'am, that will be having some test, etc. on online test or something like that.
No, ma'am, there will be no online test. You have to fill the feedback form at around 4-ish. I think we will share the feedback form in the afternoon. Please do fill that feedback form, because your feedback will be important to us, and it will also help us get back to you. We have few questions if you are interested to conduct the workshop, stuff like that. So it will help us to get each other, we'll know you better, and we'll, while we are conducting the next workshop, we'll improve our stuff and we'll add more topics. So I request each one of you to fill the feedback form whenever it is shared. So since the FOT session is over early, but there is no online test, ma'am, to answer your question.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Okay.
There might be some MCQ questions in the feedback form itself, but that is just to check whether we are not going to judge you on those MCQs, but we would want you to attempt and answer those questions. But there is no in general test as such.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. Okay.
Thank you.
So you can stay connected. Professor Mahajan will come in about 5-10 minutes, and he can address you if you have any more deeper questions or general questions on optimization.
Rupak, I have a question. This is Banurekha.
Yes, ma'am.
NLC is a function which takes argument as x inside, but when we call that function, we are calling it as only NLC.
So because we are only mentioning the name, what function should fmincon use to find out the NLC, find out the non-linear distance? You only need the name. You only need to pass the name.
Okay. So will the algorithm itself decide which value to pass to NLC function?
No. Essentially, see x naught. If you are talking about the last problem.
Yes. Last and the before one. We were using NLC.
Okay. Before one. So before one, when you use NLC, you define x naught, right? Zero.
Yes. Yes.
So x naught is already available with fmincon. That is what is the input to the NLC, right?
Okay. Yeah. But when we are calling a user defined function, it is declared as it takes an argument inside. So will not there be any syntax errors because of that?
No. So fmincon is also a user defined function, right? In a way. So fmincon itself is a user defined function, and
we are
passing all the inputs to it, right?
Okay. Thank you.
The question is valid. I understood what you're trying to ask. Was I clear? Did you understand what I'm trying to say?
Yes, I understood, but I'm specifically talking about the last equation.
I understood. Yeah. So there, just like objective function, if you see, you only have to specify the name.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
So we would like to talk to some school teachers. Are those school teachers attending the workshop right now? Are there any school teachers? No. So, Rupak, can you share the screen and view the previous practice problem which they were doing? They could do that, and at one, maybe we can break for lunch because we didn't give much time to do that practice problem. So, I think we should compensate on that.
Yeah, I actually did not realize that I was not showing the practice problem.
So let's do that because we have 15 minutes. So I think we'll finish it.
What was it was?
I'll tell you.
Calling user defined functions using Xcos, right? Mm-hmm.
Yes. Calling user defined functions in Xcos.
You see.
And there was
Yes, ma'am. Please work.
There was one query regarding the practice problem that for Xcos that it was that how to change the color, like that in C scope there was that color argument, then in that it was 8 numbers 1 3 5 7 9 11, like that it was written. So what did that mean, and how do we change the color of the plot?
The spoken tutor partially gave this answer, right?
No.
The spoken tutor talk about the changing of the color?
Actually, it didn't. Listened to it. Listened to it, but I think it didn't. I don't know. I couldn't know the meaning of those arguments. Eight arguments are written in that color. Thing. So what does that mean specifically? And then how does it affect the color? Like, I tried to change different values, but it was not doing anything. But it was only saying that means I tried to give one argument only. Then it said that you need to give 8 arguments. Then I gave some random numbers, some random 8 numbers.
Okay.
So, but the color was the same of the plot and didn't change anything. So I didn't understand what does that mean.
Okay. So what I'm trying to understand is that if this action appears somewhere in the spoken tutorial, it will be helpful if you post this question on the forum.
Okay.
Yeah, if you can do that.
If you can find
out the time and the second at the spoken tutorial where, you know, this question could be useful.
I think they posted it in the practice problem only, that try to change the color. They didn't explain that argument.
Fine.
It was like that.
So essentially, Scilab, if you, like I showed help just a few minutes before, right?
Uh-huh, uh-huh, uh-huh.
Similarly, if you type help and type color,
okay,
you should be able to get. So essentially,
or help CS scope. I think I should I help CS scope, or I should write help color means.
So if you want to have want help specific to the block, you can simply right click on the block and there you will give a help option. If you choose that, it will automatically open the help window, pointing to that particular help information about the block.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
So we'll break for lunch now. It's already 1. We'll break for lunch and see you at 2. So 2 o'clock, we again have a live session on XCOS. So see you at 2.